Hey, we definitely have a lot to say, especially after our hiatus for Mother's Day. We took some time to celebrate all the mothers and hope you had a great one as well. But yeah, we have a lot to say. Hollywood, Hollywood, Hollywood. We're bringing Hollywood to you today. I can't wait to introduce you to my guest. It's just going to be a phenomenal show. I'm excited. You're listening to Let's Chew the Gum. Let's talk about it. Welcome to Let's Chew the Gum. I'm your host, Protocol. We talk a lot of things in this show. While we chew the gum, and just like every show, we always have
something for your mind.
Welcome back to this latest edition of Let's Chew the Gum, the podcast where we talk about everything from A to Z while we chew the gum. I'm your host, Protocol. And as I said in the intro, I'm very excited to have my guest on today. This brother does it all. Sing, dance, act in front of the camera, behind the camera. I even read somewhere that he is a stilt walker. I mean, he does it all. I could not tell you everything he does within the time frame of this show. But let me just welcome, and I don't know if it needs an introduction, Tezz Yancey to the show. Welcome, Tezz. Thank you for joining me on Let's Chew the Gum. How are you doing?
My pleasure, brother. I'm doing great. Thank you for having me, man. Great to be here. I'm doing wonderful.
No, that's good to hear, man. And it is definitely my pleasure to have you. You know, I've been doing quite a few shows over the last year. Well, over last two seasons, you know, I had some really upbeat shows. And then we had the incident with COVID and George Floyd and that whole summer of 2020. And things got a little bit, I won't say serious, but I focused a lot on society and what was going on, what was happening, as Marvin Gaye might say. And as of late, I've been getting back into the realm of really going back to the roots of this show, which is, you know, really talking about lots of topics, but more so, you know, bringing some light to where darkness tried to creep in. And so I'm really glad to have you on this episode, because you're such an inspiration, man. From afar, I look at your body of work and I'm amazed. And, you know, my audience, I'm sure, is going to enjoy having the opportunity to hear about, you know, what it is you do and get a chance to find out where they can see and view some of your work. But to start off, I'd like for you just to enlighten us about how does one get to become, you know, what it is you're doing. So a multifaceted entertainer in Hollywood. Where does that story begin?
Yeah, well, for me, I mean, I think that story, you know, everyone's story is their own, and, you know, everyone's journey is their own, but we all have them. We all have stories, we all have journeys, and mine, you know, mine began very young. You know, I have memories of... Eight years old is my first recollection of where I can remember being intrigued by this, the arts, you know, started with there. I mean, really the arts. And, you know, I have my two sisters. One, my middle sister, who's 11 months younger than me, we actually were very close as kids, and we still are today. But I can remember on the weekends, you know, I grew up in Boston, and we used to go down to my grandparents' house, like the whole family. So it was a house that was in my family for generations. And we used to go down to my grandparents' house on the weekends. And that was like a tradition. You know, the family would meet, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews. There'd be a big, you know, house full of relatives. And, you know, it was like the adults would get together and they would play the music, and you know, it was always that kind of festive atmosphere. And I remember my grandmother was always, you know, playing music, and I can remember at 8 years old, I'll never forget it, because the first performer I ever saw on television was Michael Jackson, actually. And I remember being a kid and just being mesmerized, like taken in, drawn in. And it was old footage of like his Jackson 5 days. So I just, to me, I was seeing this little boy that looked like me on television. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And I don't even remember what it was, because it was, you know, he was an adult at this time, but it was, you know, some special or something. And I just remember being like, who was that? And that was the beginning of it for me. And I always say to people that, to me, that was the moment that the arts chose me. You know what I mean? And so that's kind of where it began. And my sister and I remember us trying to recreate what we saw, which was I Want You Back. You know what I mean? The whole, it was like I Want You Back, The Love You Save, ABC medley. I'll never forget it. And at that point, obviously, I had no idea that that would ultimately turn into a career. But that's the power of art. That right there was, I talk about it to this day. That's the power of art. So that's really, that's kind of the genesis, if you will, of where it all began
I like
for
how
me.
you said art chose me. You know, most folks that listen now, they know I'm a teacher, and whether I'm talking to high school students or really not high schools, let me correct. I teach also. I work in a teacher training program, and so I'm dealing with a lot of young adults all the time who say they want to be a teacher. They're there because they want to be a teacher. But for the majority of them, and most of them, I tell them, you're already a teacher, right? That kind of chose you. Like, to me, teachers are born, and it's much like what you're saying with the art. Art chose you, right? It was just, and it's blossomed into a career, and that's always a beautiful thing when you can work in your passion. It's like you never really have a day of work. You're just living your passion, and
Absolutely.
that's how it's seen. That's how I see you. It looks effortless.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? I find it, you know, I completely agree with it. I find it so interesting because, again, at that point, I had no idea that that was the beginning of, you know, a lifelong love and passion, to your point. Because I can remember, you know, even in middle school and stuff, and getting towards high school, you know, it was like the teachers, you know, people trying to figure out what they want to do. Kids in my class and stuff. It's like, and that was the discussion where I remember being so confused. Where I was like, oh, you know, what is it you know want to do? It take the time to think about it. And I remember thinking, like, doesn't everyone know? You know what I mean? Like at that point,
Right.
like, doesn't everyone know what they're passionate about? I had no idea. How would I? I had no idea. And I actually didn't even realize, you know, I mean, obviously seeing Michael Jackson, I just thought that that was one route. I mean, but I say that because you initially asked about this multifaceted thing, and you know, I'm so fortunate. I'm so blessed and fortunate that I saw an artist like Michael Jackson as a child, because obviously as time went on, I realized, you know, he was cut from the cloth of the greats. I mean, the greats, you know, and it's because of Michael. I've always been like a sponge. You know, I really have always been like a curious sponge, soaking stuff up, curious about everything. And I remember thinking even back then, like, who inspired him? You know, so I looked, and because of Michael Jackson, I discovered James Brown. I discovered Sammy Davis Jr. I discovered Fred Astaire. You know what I mean? Jackie Wilson. Like, these are people that were before my time, and that really began to really open up the door. Because when you talk about someone like, say, a Sammy, you're talking about a guy who, you know, incredible singer, incredible dancer, incredible actor, incredible musician. You know what I mean? And
Absolutely.
so that opened up my world to theater, which ultimately ended up being my major in college, musical theater. I had no idea at that or at an early age that that was even a possibility in terms of really making a career of it. So I know I'm so blessed, and I recognize that fully. I acknowledge it fully. Like, it's not, that's not something that happens necessarily every day to everyone. I was just meant to see who I was meant to see, and it opened up a whole world. And I'm so grateful for it.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I said, the passion and the joy of it comes through. And whenever I've seen a performance of yours, or whenever I've heard you speak of it, you know, it's you were talking about who inspired Michael Jackson, and so when you asked the question, you know, the teacher sort of came out of me, and I'm over here, I'm doodling on the page, and I wrote Jackie Wilson, James Brown, Fred Astaire, Sammy Davis, and then you named them all off, right? So great mind
Hey,
think alike. That's
look, absolutely, man. And look, I mean that. I'm like, I stand on their shoulders, you know what I mean? And I really mean that, like I do. And it's interesting. You and I met in Vegas years
Yes.
ago, and it's funny. It's so funny when you started this podcast off by mentioning this. I love that you mentioned the stilt walking, because that's actually from the show that you saw when we met. I don't know if we had that in the show at that point, but that was from that show. And that was, we were doing, as you may remember, we've essentially, at that time, I had a deal with the New York Hotel and Casino in
That's
Vegas, and
right.
we would essentially, yeah, we were essentially
Apple
doing
Bar.
Apple Bar, yeah. And we turned that bad boy into a showroom of our own, and we were doing theater with pop music, really. I mean, pop and funk, and we were taking, pop, funk, jazz, whatever music, and we were putting theater on it because that's the background I came from. And the guy I was working with, we actually met doing a Broadway show, and we came from that world. And the stilts, the whole st we learned to walk on stilts on our own because we had this whole concept of opening up our show, because we were taking people on what we called a fantastic voyage,
Oh
right?
yeah,
And
Lakeside.
so we took that Lakeside song, and we said, wouldn't it be crazy if we came out like on stilts as like the ringleaders? And that's how that's how stuff was born. We would say things like that and go, let's do it. You know what I mean?
Why
So
not?
I
Yeah.
added stilts to my special skills on my resume, you
That,
know?
hey, that's outstanding, and that's different. I distinctly remember that day, and I think that's what attracted me to walk in there. I remember walking through the casino. This must have been 2000 some odd back, some years back. It's been some years. 2000, I don't know if it was 2010 or 2002, but it was at least a couple of decades, I think. But I remember walking through the casino and hearing this performance, and I said, man, that's just not a regular performance. And I walked in, and I was mesmerized. I was stuck, and I don't know if I saw the stilts because I didn't catch the beginning, but I could see just how you described it, of you bringing pop music, etc., and into a theater production and making it a theater production, and it worked. It worked for sure. And here we are all these years later, and it's
That's right.
still working for you. No,
That's right.
one of the things I also wanted to talk about is, not only do you perform in a variety of ways, but you've added to that. I don't know if it's added or if you've always done this, but you also teach the skills and the craft. You teach that to individuals, and I think sometimes those that do it best are those that can teach it.
Yeah, I think that I've learned that is not, that's true sometimes. I mean, not everyone who are, not every, performer's a good, makes a good teacher. I mean, it's, teaching in and of itself is a skill in and of itself, because it's an interesting thing. It's like this, it's not like you meet at the intersection of like being in control and also letting go. It's like Control Avenue and Letting Go Street. You know what I mean? It's like that's the intersection where you meet, because there's a certain humility I think good teachers have. And any teacher I remember, and there's certain ones I remember, like my 7th grade teacher, Miss Dudley. You know what I mean? There's certain ones I
Right.
remember. You know, that, and I'll never, and I have a story about that, by the way. Remind me about the Miss Dudley story. I have to tell you this.
Oh, I gotta
It's
hear it.
very interesting how things work. Yeah, I'll tell you that in a second. But I say that because I remember she was one of those people that was incredibly encouraging when I needed it, and also incredibly motivating. And sometimes that motivation came through kind of a tough love, get off your, you know, rump kind of thing. And other times it was, you know, pat you on the back. And that's a really interesting skill. So to answer your question, yeah, I actually, the teaching aspect for me, it's become a different, well, we're in a different world, right? As you mentioned with this pandemic. But it's become a different, I've discovered a different side of it through this pandemic, and rightly so. But even prior to the lockdown and all that, you know, I was again very fortunate. I used to do master classes regularly, like if, you know, even a lot of times if I was doing a tour in a different city, you're going to teach master classes. Like that's a way to make extra money. It's a way to keep your skills set up. It's a way to interact with people and pass stuff along. So I would do master classes. I'm very fortunate that I have friends in this business that I've met through the years, whether it's from New York, Broadway days, or Vegas, or Hollywood, or whatever. And some friends of mine that happened to open up their own dance studios or music studios or what have you, and they would bring me out. There's a really good friend of mine. She and her husband, she got married. I worked with her in Vegas, and they got married and ended up moving to Missoula, Montana, of all places. I think I was telling you this.
And, yeah, right.
Yeah, and she opened up a performing arts studio for kids, and she used to bring me out twice a year. And if I wasn't doing something, you know, a film or something, I would go out twice a year and do a music workshop and then a acting and dance workshop. So I was definitely doing it. I guess at that time I looked at it more as like I found a niche for teaching. The passion has come through in this pandemic, I got to tell you, because, you know, I've just met people from all over the world. And a lot of it had to do with self-care that we all needed being locked in our homes, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. And using technology to reach out. And it's been really powerful. And again, I look at it from the perspective of, you know, it's so important to pass these things down, particularly to people who are hungry for it, you know? And I remember, as I mentioned, I remember the teachers that were giving from grade school to college. I mean, teachers at I went to Boston Conservatory Music in Berkeley, and I remember teachers there that were just, you know, they let me stay later in the studio to work, or that, you know what I mean? They saw the passion and nurtured it, so. So I love it.
No, man, it's great. And speaking of teachers, last week was Teacher Appreciation Week. So we appreciate Ms. Dudley for being a part of your growth and all the teachers. You know, I have the same. I always think of Ms. Bayard and Ms. Slappy. And there's so many that are, you know, that we can remember that were influential in our lives. So thank you to those teachers. But you got to tell me, you piqued my curiosity about Ms. Dudley. I got to hear this story.
Man, this is amazing. So again, Miss Dudley, Betsy Dudley. I love that I'm saying her name, and I would love to get this podcast to her at some point. But seventh grade teacher, and she was one of these teachers, as I already mentioned. She just had a great balance of understanding how to nurture, and she was incredibly encouraging. And that was a time of my life. You know, again, I guess 11, 12 at the time, and I had this passion for the arts. And, you know, there were a lot of people that viewed the arts there were a lot of adults that would say, oh yeah, you know, that's cute, or have something to fall back on, or oh, it's very competitive. Those were things I heard a lot coming up. And I remember thinking even then, I mean, architecture is competitive. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
like
right.
Glass making is competitive. Pick a profession that's competitive. But for some reason, when people think about, you know, being an actor, having to do auditions, or, you know, it's somehow seen in a different light. So I can remember kind of having moments of, I never doubted what I wanted to do, but when enough people would almost be discouraging, she was one that was just always there to say, follow your passion. That gut feeling you have in you is a real thing, you know? And so fast forward to, I'm trying to remember the year. It was years later, but I was performing. I booked a job. I was actually performing on a cruise ship, right? Of all things I'm doing. It was actually four shows on the ship, but it was my first cruise ship I ever did. I've done a couple. And it was an amazing experience because I'm not too far to college. And the ship is out of Greece. So we're over in Greece. I mean, it's beautiful. We're touring, you know, we're going through the Mediterranean Italy and Spain. And yeah, we're in Greece. And we were docked in Greece and we were doing our show. And it was like this Broadway style review where we get done with the show and we're backstage changing. And the cruise director comes in and says, "Hey, Tezz, there's a woman in the audience who just watched the show who says, she says she was your seventh grade teacher." And I'm like, "What?
Wow."
So sure enough, I go out and over in Greece, and I went to school in Boston, over in Greece.
Wow.
Sure enough, it's Bessie Dudley on the ship. And she said, you know, when they introduced me, she said she was watching the show going, "That looks like that's Tezz." And she said when they did the intros at the end of the show, she heard the name, it just confirmed it.
Wow. But
isn't that something? And it was just amazing to be able to say to her, you know, a large part of the reason why I'm doing this is because you were one that encouraged me.
That is an amazing story. That's amazing.
Isn't that amazing?
It had to be amazing, just as amazing for her. I would imagine just her swelling up with pride or maybe even a tear. I don't know, but that is that's amazing. That far away, those many years later, and this person that encouraged you to follow that gut feeling, and that's a great thing. And you're right. I've heard so many people, and you know, it's almost cliche when you know to get a backup plan. Anyone that wants to go into the arts, it's always discouraged. And I imagine that oftentimes it's discouraged by individuals who don't have that passion, or individuals that may have had that passion, but something in their life change that for them, or some individual or some situation they were not able to overcome, and they have a fear, and you can't live on fear, and you never want to be in one of those situations where you're thinking back years later, "I wonder if." It's like, you know, go for it, man, live that passion, because you only get that one chance.
Well, and you know what, I do want to just say, I mean, you know, I do recognize, you know, first of all, there's this incredible conditioning, almost a universal conditioning of life that people just fall into. I mean, that's just a real thing. And I think on some level, that could play a role in it, where it's just kind of a habitual thing. Maybe they were told that coming up, you know what I mean?
Right.
And also, I don't necessarily think it's I don't know, it may not be, you know, ill-intentioned, if you will. But that's the power of, you know, people's influence on you, and the things you say do matter. Like, we have power as human beings. We really do. The things we say matter.
Absolutely.
You know, and I can remember hearing those things, and from different people. And so you never know. So I try to be aware of that. I mean, we're all flawed, you know, but, you know, one of the things I do when I teach my classes, whenever I have new people come in, I always start the same way by just saying, "Look, let's just lay some things out, kind of some boundaries, if you will." And I always say, you know, when you're dealing with acting classes and things, or you know, anything dealing with sensitivity and emotions, that's music or dance, all of it deals with it. You know, things may come up, and we all deal with things differently, I think it's important to acknowledge those kinds of things up front, because, you know, we're all conditioned in some ways. And so I think a lot of it can kind of come from that. And I just think it's important to acknowledge those things. But again, the power of the power that we have, I think sometimes we don't either recognize or I think it's good to just acknowledge it.
No, absolutely. I definitely feel where you're coming from, that the power of words to be able to manifest what you see or what you want to see in your life. And you can do some damage and take it away by using the wrong type of words. I think that's why they call it a spell or spelling, right? You got to be careful what you say. Be careful what you say. I want to take a quick break, but after the break, I want to come back and talk about, that the power of positivity, the benefit of acting, and I want to talk about your improv classes that you teach. I want to get into some topics that's in this realm of where a lot of people are focusing on mental health. I want to come back and also talk about how acting or the arts can be used as a healing mechanism.
Cool.
All right, we'll be right back. You're listening to Let's Chew the Gum, the podcast where we talk about everything from A to Z while we chew the gum. Look for us, email us at letschewthegum@gmail.com if you have show topics, like to be a guest on the show, and definitely to submit questions for myself or the guest that I have. We'll be right back.
I remember
fresh on the back, custom fresh on the side. Get it how you want it, know you like it like that.
Melting pots, teas, and banks offering custom apparel made to order with fast turnarounds and competitive pricing. Check us out today for your next project. That's mptnz.com.
MPTNZ, it's so easy. Load it in your browser, get yourself some custom tees. MPTNZ, it's so easy. Load it in your browser, get yourself some custom tees, or some custom shoes, or some custom hats, or some custom this, or some custom that.
MPTs and things, yeah, we got all of that. MPTs and things, yeah, we got all of that.
Thank you for listening to our sponsors. We're back with my special guest, Mr. Tezz Yancey, entertainer extraordinaire, sing, produce, act, dance, you name it, he does it. And I wanted to get back into this and talk about how you are utilizing your skill sets now, because you have you're teaching or conducting improv classes. And I think that's one of the purest forms of art, because it to me, it's when it's not scripted, it's and we were just mentioning this off camera or off recording, it's natural and it flows. And so I wanted to give the audience a chance to hear about your improv class, maybe, your approach to it and how they could become involved in possibly taking some of those classes.
Sure. Improv is something that I mentioned that, I went to the conservatory and I studied musical theater. So, you study, it's acting, it's dance, it's all those things you mentioned. And improv has always been a form of an aspect of training for me. That's really where it began for me. I'm talking even dramatic improv. I came up in a school where, if you're doing a play or you're doing a scene or whatever, there's a moment in the rehearsal process where you drop the script and you get, the gist of the story, the gist of the plot, or the gist of the feel, and you improvise it because you're looking to discover things. So that's a huge training tool. So when I started taking it, whenever I would move to somewhere, like when I lived in New York, when I lived in Vegas, when I came to LA, whenever I moved to a new place, I always lined up my training stuff. Like, let me find a good voice teacher. Let me go find good dance classes. Let me find good acting classes. And improv is always another one of those, let me find a good improv class. There's something incredibly freeing about it. And to your point, it's the closest thing to real life, because like real life, we're having this conversation now and I'm answering your question, but it's in real time. You know what I mean? I'm thinking about it. It's still in the moment. And improv is the closest thing to that. And that's incredibly both freeing and incredibly frightening.
Right. You never know what's going to come out.
Yeah. And I think that you know, I really do believe that this idea of stepping into this fear, it's easy to say these things. It's easy to say it. But when you do it and you're petrified, there's something amazing that happens on the other side of it, because you always come out on the other side. And so, yeah, so these class, you know, my decision to open up my classes through Zoom has really, again, I was coaching and stuff before the pandemic, but during the pandemic, a lot of my self-care, a lot of my what kept me emotionally and mentally stable, to be honest with you, being locked in a house. I mean, you know, it was a lot of improv. I was doing a lot of online improv jams, and I would just get up. I mean, I'm talking around the world. There were jams, there still are jams in India, Barcelona, UK, Africa, you know, here. And I would get up at 4 a.m. and do a jam in India, because I'm, you know, it was necessary to my self-care. And so that was the way I approached it from the teaching aspect, and it's grown into this and continues to grow into this incredible community of people who are really being empowered, including me teaching it. Mm-hmm. It's incredibly empowering. And it really does help every aspect of what I do as an artist. It makes me a better singer, a better dancer, but yeah, it really does, because it's like, there's a level of freedom that you discover, yeah, that we all have, but we're willing to step into it.
Yeah, I like how you use the word discover again. I can just imagine, you know, you're discovering something about the world outside of you, but more importantly, you're discovering something about yourself. You know, if you commit to it and you let go and you know, you let go of the fear or the hesitance. It also makes me think about, you know, how therapeutic that could be, because I know that often psychologists, possibly psychiatrists, use role play as a tool to help their patients to either get in touch or to conquer a fear or to transcend a moment where they may have some type of block. So and I think that type of role playing, you know, although they may be rehearsing something that previously happened or occurred or situation, but it's still a form of improv. And I just think that I think that for the general public, you know, maybe those on the inside may see this, but I think it's underestimated as a tool for therapy, as a tool. And as you said, for self-care, I can only imagine, you know, through the pandemic, you know, how great that must have been as a tool, or some place to escape, or some place to put the emotions or the feelings, no matter what they may be, as opposed to them just residing within oneself. You know what I mean?
Absolutely right. No, you're exactly right. And you know, it's like I do my regular weekly classes, but I also do, you know, workshops, and then I'm even doing some of these, like you mentioned, sort of a therapeutic type thing. I hesitate to use that word sometimes because I want to cross that line, but it very much is. It's self-care and also corporate. And I'm doing some, you know, very business people who are just looking to, I mean, they're looking to just to be more open and more free. And improv, this type of improv is collaborative. That's the other part of it that's so beautiful. And going back to the self-care aspect of it, that's one of the things that was just nice, just to get on a screen or get in a room with people, just to understand that you're not alone in all this. And so there's something really empowering about, like, collaborating with someone, so you actually depend on other people and they depend on you, so that's hugely beneficial in so many ways, because you know, you get out into the real world and you're willing to listen to people. You're actually who doesn't want to be heard and seen? Everyone wants those two things, to be seen and to be heard. Yeah. And that's an enormous part of improv, at least the way I approach it.
No, I can see that. I can see that. You know, I have this idea of, and you mentioned being hesitant to use the word therapeutic or therapy. So I won't use that word in my description, but I'm just thinking about, you know, art and its many uses in society. And I have this, so it's not really a saying, it's just something that I wrote down that made sense to me. But I wrote down that acting or performing, it serves as an attraction. It serves as a distraction, but it also has the power to cause a reaction, right? So it's attractive to us. Sometimes it's distracting from the day-to-day norms or situations like a pandemic. It's a world where you can escape and you can see yourself or find yourself. It can be inspiring that way. It can be life-changing. And because it can also cause reactions, right? We can use art in so many ways to, you know, it's been used to lift people up, to inspire people, to emote certain types of perspectives or to show different concepts. And so I was thinking about, you know, how could, you know, someone like you or anyone for that matter, you know, use art or use these type of improvs in that way to maybe even attract a broader group or a broader audience that they're looking for something. They need that attraction. They need that distraction. And then, you know, with all good intentions to help them to react in a certain way. You know, there's so many things that are going on in society. As I said, just you know, you can turn on the television and it's just one thing after another. And those things tend to can build on a person. They can become stressful. I know, like you said, this is real time. These aren't rehearsed questions, or I didn't pre-give you these questions. So forgive me for just putting you on the spot.
No, but it was all good.
But you know, how can we use art to maybe as a remedy to some of those social ills?
Well, I think that's an amazing saying. You hit the nail on the head. I mean, it's already the point of art. I mean, it's like you mentioned, you said attraction. People are attracted to the arts, right? On many levels. I mean, everyone, whether it's music, right? Dance, Netflix, you know what I mean? Theater.
Right.
I mean, people are already attracted to us. And I understand that part of that, there's a celebrity aspect of it that comes into play too, which I get that. I get that too. I mean, I don't, you know, I'm in a different space where I understand the celebrity thing. I'm attracted more so to the actual art aspect of it. So people are already attracted to it, right?
Right.
And then you mentioned distraction, you said next, right?
Yes.
And again, escapism comes to mind. That is a huge part of the arts. When you think about it, that's one of the primary, I guess, how do I say it, points or uses of art. It's always been escapism. You know, people go to the theater or go to the movies or to escape their reality for a couple hours. Like, that's precisely, I mean, you know, you could put sports in there too, right?
Yes.
Go to a game or whatever, and it's a couple hours to get away from your stuff, right? So that is a huge aspect. And then reaction, that to me is, again, acting to me is reacting, right? And I'm talking about at its core.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're talking about, you could be doing a monologue or just in a room alone, and you're reacting to the environment. That's my scene partner, you know, the weather, whatever, you know. So, and getting a reaction from people. I mean, you know how it is. You mentioned Marvin Gaye earlier. I don't know if that was on the podcast or before we started recording, but you mentioned Marvin Gaye. And it's like, yeah, that as soon as you said.
Oh, I'm gonna have to have you repeat that because you're breaking
up.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to get you to repeat that for the audience because you broke up at that point. You said as soon as I mentioned his name, and then it broke up.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, I was saying, you mentioned Marvin Gaye earlier, and I don't remember if it was before you started recording or not, but as soon as you mentioned his name, I heard what's going on. You know what I mean? I heard you know, Mercy, Mercy Me. Mm-hmm. Like those, you talk about getting a reaction, and those are obviously political and powerful. But any song and music, that's the point. It's meant to inspire a reaction from people. So it's already being done. Now, in terms of how it can reach wider audiences and stuff like that, I think, you know, in many ways, through teaching, like I mentioned, Zoom, my classes, again, I have people from all over the world coming to these classes, and it's incredible. I did an improv jam today. And I have, it was, and we did the jam, and at the end, we just hang out and talk for about 10, 15 minutes. And I'm listening to the different dialects, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Of people interacting. India, UK, Africa, LA, you know, Philly, you know, New York. And I'm hearing all these different dialects. And I'm saying, this is how you get it out to people. This is, you know, this is one way. Yeah, so there's you know, and there's a lot of other ways, you know, but that's the first thing that comes to my mind, just because I'm freshly in it right now.
Yeah, absolutely. Now I hope that some of my audience members that are in those countries that you named, because we're you know, getting responses from people all over the world, and it'd be great if we could you know, get them to your channel to have that experience. You know, I you gave me an invitation to pop in, and I definitely plan to, man. And, you know, I'd like
anytime.
To.
Anytime. You work yeah, anytime.
Yeah, for sure. I definitely want to be a part of that, get others to become a part of that. I'm excited about the idea and the transformative power of arts and the transformative power of improv in particular. We can talk about all of it. And, you know, I know years ago, yeah, you know, I've done a lot of, you know, public speaking throughout the mm-hmm. state and the country and whatnot. And I used to, you know, prepare my speech and blah, 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 blah. But at one point, you know, I just, like you said, in art, at some point you drop the script. You get the gist mm-hmm. of what it's about. You get the gist of the story, and it doesn't need to be rehearsed. And I can honestly say, you know, it's been years since I've prepared a speech that I was going to give. I'll go out and I'm speaking from the heart, or speaking about what I know, speaking about what I came to speak about. And much like improv, it can be not necessarily terrifying, but at the same time, you know, you're talking to an audience where everyone is not always receptive. But I'm a firm believer that the individuals, or that individual that needed to be there on that day to hear that word or that portion, they're there. And so that message transcends those radio waves. You know, they reach the antennas where they're supposed to, you know, to be attracted to. So I just want to again, just applaud you on that and encourage the listeners to consider coming on to one of your classes. So before we wind up, we got to get the information out there so that they can do that. So I know that they can access it on Facebook, but give us the rundown. We'll put it in the show description, but give us the rundown on all the ways that they can contact you or to become a part of this improv session.
Sure. Yeah, I make it real, real easy. I mean, so that's one of the advantages of social media, right? And I'm out, you know, also if people don't have it, I obviously do through my email. People can contact me through that, but which is, you know, I don't have a problem giving it's my name at Gmail, Tezz Yancey at Gmail. I get a lot of inquiries through email, but because interestingly enough, a lot of people are on social media and I respect that too. But for those who are, you know, I make it easy. I mean, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and all of those are just at my name, Tezz Yancey. You know, and they can, I always do events on Instagram and Facebook and Instagram, and I also post on Twitter. So you can find any of the events there. And again, some people who, I don't know, sometimes social media is funky. So sometimes people go, oh, I don't, you know, they'll message me directly because they, once they know my name, they can message me. So I make it really easy. I'm actually going to be coming up soon. I'm redoing my website as well. And once that's up, everything also funnels through my website, which once that's back up will be tezzworld.com. That's easy.
Love it.
TEZZworld.com.
Love it, love it. I'm just going to spell the name out for those. It's Tezzyancey at Tezz Yancey. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, TezzYancey@gmail.com. Be sure to contact him for those class sessions and see what that's all about. I want to really say again, thank you for coming on the show and sharing this. And I've said this to a few people, and some folks have taken me up on it, but I really would love to have you back for this topic and many more. I think there's a lot you have to offer that not only my immediate audience could benefit from, but an expanded audience that we'll be reaching also.
Oh, absolutely. Man, I'm more than happy to come back. I was thinking about your intro. You know, it's like, yeah, we could spend a whole hour talking about the Broadway days, the Vegas days.
Oh my goodness.
As a matter of fact, tomorrow, that's funny, I was just gonna say this last thing you mentioned, talking about improv. And I want you to just make this point clear, like while dropping the script. Yeah, I love improv and I also love scripted work. Like tomorrow, Saturday, I'm actually going to a premiere, which is incredible because, you know, it's obviously socially distanced and safe. They've rented out this theater and a certain number of people are going in there so we can be spaced out in the seats. But it's a premiere of a film I did, powerful film. I'm really excited about it. It's finally coming out. It was supposed to come out last year, but the pandemic happened. And it's a powerful film based about cyberbullying, kids and cyberbullying. And it's a really powerful piece based sadly on true events, mm-hmm. but they're finally doing a red carpet premiere thing out here in LA. And I'm going to get to go see that and enjoy that. But I say that because that's all scripted work and there's power in that as well, you know, and I will say, as much as it was scripted, improv helped me so much with the role I played,
right?
Because it freed me up to react to certain things.
Oh yeah,
and I'm telling you, so I'm so grateful for that.
Yeah, let me just to my audience, I don't want to pigeonhole and just improv. I got on this improv thing, I got so excited, but definitely you are into scripted work. I mean, you've been in plays and you've been in movies and TV shows and commercials and all the above, and I like how you said, you know, the power of scripted work, because in that there's the intention, right? There's the intention of how you're going to script something to, you know, get the emotion or the reaction or the attraction, or how you're going to tell the story and what does that look like? You know, you're crafting it to create this picture or this image in the mind of the viewer. So that is definitely important. You know, it's like when I teach, or when I'm teaching other teachers, I always say, everything that you do is with some intention. When you go into my classroom, you may see things on the wall, but they're intentionally put there. I may say something to a class. It's intentionally done that way. You know, everything has a purpose in that realm. So let me not underestimate or de-emphasize the role that you play, the benefit of the scripted work as well.
Yeah, I love how you put that. That's great. Yeah, absolutely.
All right, folks. Again, my guest has been Tezz Yancey. This has been a blast. It's been enjoyable. You're listening to Let's Chew the Gum, the podcast where we talk about everything from A to Z. Be sure to listen in where you are listening now, but we're also on Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Spreaker, Spotify, Deezer, Podbean, wherever you can find a podcast, we're there. And if we're not there, send me an email. I'll make sure we get there for you. Thank you for your time. We'll see you next time. And as always, we always have something for your mind. Something for your mind. Something for your mind. Something for your mind.